Good evening, and welcome to the debate featuring the candidates for the Georgia GOP State Party Chair. This debate is hosted by the 9th District Republican Party and the Lumpkin GOP. Our debate is being live streamed this evening by Metro News on fymtv.com. Our moderator for the evening is Todd, Rehm, editor of georgiapundit.com. Our format for the evening is this. Each candidate will have a 3-minute opening remark. Immediately after the opening remarks, the moderator, Todd Rehm, will ask questions alternating to the left from who gave the opening remarks until each candidate has had an opportunity to answer the questions. The questions will include items that the moderator has prepared ahead of time, as well as items that are submitted from the audience before this debate begins. No questions will come directly from the floor, and questions will have to address all candidates, not one specifically. Each candidate will have 1 minute to answer the questions, with each candidate given 30 seconds rebuttal to any question that they are specifically calling out on. Each candidate will then have a 3-minute closing. Prior to tonight's event, each candidate pulled numbers on how they would go with the order of this debate. And our first question this evening, when questions begin, will go to Alex Johnson. I now turn you over to our moderator, Todd Rehm, for tonight's State GOP Chairman's Debate.
Good evening. Thanks for having me. So the first question will begin with Alex Johnson, and that is, please discuss... I'm sorry, 3-minute opening for Alex Johnson.
Thank you all very much for having me here today. I'm Alex Johnson, for those of you who don't
know. Okay,
do you
need the microphone?
Thank you, everyone, for having me here today. I'm Alex Johnson. I'm running for Georgia GOP chairman. For those of you who don't know me, I've been involved in politics in Georgia for a long time. Since 2003, I was involved in the College Republicans at Oglethorpe University. In 2009, I was involved in my local party in DeKalb County. In DeKalb County in 2010, I ran for state senate in the Democratic district. I got about 43% of the vote there. I was chairman of the DeKalb County Young Republicans. I was legal counsel at the DeKalb County Republican Party. I've run for chairman of the state party a couple times before, in 2013 and 2015. All that information is available online at advancedgop.com. It talks about everything since then. I've been advertising to the state, letting people know exactly what's been going on in Georgia politics, the things going on in the party, and trying to get more people involved. I think that what we need to be doing moving forward in Georgia is we need to focus on the credibility of our brand, growing county parties, and definitely fundraising. When it comes down to the credibility of our brand, the only reason people are going to be involved in the Republican Party and get involved in GOP and in local chapters is if we're credible, if we're out in public doing something and doing things on the state level, putting out advertisements, getting people involved, letting people know what the Georgia Republican Party stands for. We have over 2 million Republican voters in Georgia in this last presidential election, and people need to know we exist. And that will help us grow county parties. Growing county parties is vital. Turnout is getting low, and we need people to be on the ground working hard to get people elected. And the state party needs to be providing services to voters and to the county parties in order to make the streak stronger. We lost Cobb and Gwinnett counties this year to Hillary Clinton. That's not a good thing. Those are heavily Republican counties historically, and the current trends, we need to be fighting harder. And by doing those things, we can definitely start raising money, more money. Because right now, if you look at the Georgia GOP finances, it's about $260,000 more owed than cash on hand. That's the state Republican Party. You can find all the information about that on the FEC website, fec.gov. It shows every donation in, every expenditure out. And the real underlying point is, why are we raising money? What is the money going to be used for? Is it going to be used for this elite political insider consultant class, or is it going to be used to grow the grassroots? Will it be used to get more people involved in the GOP? Because again, over 2 million Trump voters in this last election. The question is, how many are involved in the GOP, and are we going to be able to expand the number involved in order to expand our donor base? So with that, I'd appreciate your vote. Please check out advancedgop.com. It shows everything from the past 4 years, very transparent. You know exactly where I stand.
Thank you very much.
Good evening, everyone. I'm so thankful that you all have come out to hear from us tonight. Thank you for everyone that is a part of this evening tonight and worked very hard to bring us to this point. My name is Michael McNeely. I'm running for chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. I want to share with you a little bit about me. I know many of you because I've been serving in the grassroots of this party for many years. But I just want to go over a little bit about my background and where how I got here today. I grew up in a little town called Rehm, Georgia. It's in Jefferson County near Augusta. Rural community with my mother and father. And I have a great mother and father because at 9 months old, they adopted me. And so the right to life issue is very important to me. And they taught me so many great things. My life has been focused on dedication to God and the country. I served in the I was in Boy Scouts and earned my Eagle Scout. I graduated high school. I went to George Southern University, earned a degree in criminal justice. Was a police officer for 14 years. Also served in the Georgia National Guard, Army National Guard. And I came to Atlanta serving in the Army National Guard. I'm currently an executive with a state agency of over 4,000 employees and a $325 million budget. In the party, I've served as Georgia Black Republican Council Chair. I was the political director for the Georgia Young Republicans, currently first vice chair, and I was third and first vice chair in my county, in Douglas County. So, got a lot of experience, both outside of politics and inside of politics. I work very, very hard to engage all communities, millennials, young people, minorities, and to grow our party and welcome everybody in. I remember when I first came to the party and nobody knew my name, I didn't know a soul, but I got involved because of the principles that I believe in. I'm both a fiscal and a social conservative. I stand on those principles. I work hard to help get Republicans elected to do the things that we all do so that our families can get the things that they need in life, not because of government, because of their own individual effort. I'm glad to be here today. I want to earn your vote to become the next chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. And again, thank you for being here tonight. And we've got a lot more to talk about, and I'll be glad to answer any questions and work with you to grow our party and ensure that we're on the standing that we need to, because we know some things are broken, but they're not insurmountable problems. We can fix it, and we will.
Good evening. My name is John Watson. Like the rest of these gentlemen, a candidate for chairman of the Georgia Republican Party. Quick bit of background. I have been involved in Georgia Republican politics, campaigns, and the state party for nearly 25 years. My career in state politics began working for Congressman Bob Barr in the 1994 contract with America cycle. Many of you all remember that. I was Bob's finance director. After Bob's successful campaign, I was honored to be selected by Chairman Rusty Paul as the finance director of the Georgia Republican Party. I have been a professional fundraiser and have done so throughout my career. After that effort with Chairman Paul, I had the honor of being the campaign manager for Attorney General Mike Bowers in his effort for governor. After that, was able to be the chief, before that, I had the opportunity to serve with Chairman Ralph Reed as the foundation chairman, again, running a fundraising organization. I was the chief political consultant and later chief of staff, Governor Sonny Perdue, when we accomplished the unthinkable, which was to take Georgia after 135 years of Democratic rule and turn it into Republican dominance. Of late, I've been the campaign chairman for David Perdue and his Senate effort. Ladies and gentlemen, the Georgia Republican Party is at a crossroads. Of late, we saw the fact that unfortunately in Cobb, in Gwinnett, and Henry, we lost on the presidential race. As importantly, and you've all seen the finances or heard about the finances announced in reference to it, but after 15 years of Republican dominance, the Democratic Party in Georgia has more money on hand than we do. It is frankly a disgrace, and as we prepare for 2018, the critical election cycle ahead, if that continues, we have the chance of losing. Obviously, I have a background in finance, but as importantly, I have a long history of work with the grassroots conservatives that are this party. I've never been in a campaign whereby we did not cherish, embrace, support, and do everything necessary to be a grassroots campaign. I will continue to do as a chairman. I appreciate your time and the opportunity to be here this evening.
Good evening. I think by now you know what office we're running.
all that get to something you don't know. That's a little bit about me. First of all, thank you so much for coming out tonight. It's just a wonderful joy to be back in the North Georgia Mountains. This is my birthplace. I was born just down the road in Clayton. Went to high school in DeKalb County and off to UGA with just about everybody else in my graduating class. I happened to catch my wife on the track, Susie Welsh. She started the women's track team at UGA, and that's where we met. And I have a degree there in finance. And then I liked it so much, went back, got another one in the county, and ended up with a child being born there, one of my four. Started with a daughter, and Alex, and then my son, Daniel, and they're married with children. In fact, today is a big day. We got to welcome my fourth granddaughter today, Ellie Grace, getting at 9:06 this morning. She's a good girl. My son Samuel couldn't be with us tonight. He's playing in a championship game of a basketball tournament, so he couldn't make it. But my daughter Grace is with us tonight. Grace is really a gorgeous girl, and inside and out. And she was the 2016 Tar of the Year. And last summer, she interned for Secretary of State Brian Kemp in his Corporations Division. And this coming summer, she'll be interning with Senator David Perdue up in Washington. Her desire is to work in the State Department and eventually go to this little country called South Korea. I have no idea why, but I thought Georgia was great. So anyway, after all that said and done, I got a good job and working for some big companies and doing a lot of things. And my main focus in my career is helping companies be lean, mean, and efficient. And that's exactly what I want to do for the Georgia Republican Party. I want to help this party be lean, mean, and efficient. And I have the skills and talents to do that. I'm looking forward to that opportunity. Thank you very much.
The first question, and if I understand it correctly, we're going to be starting with Mr. McNeely.
Alex, yes, first question.
Is please tell us what you think the role of the Republican Party is in state and local politics. You can talk about your vision. You can talk about things we have done well in the past, things we haven't done well in the past, but give us an idea of what you think the state Republican Party ought to be doing.
Thank you, Todd. The Republican Party in the past has done a great job of the fact that we're a red state. I mean, we want to carry the state for Trump. That's awesome. The Republican Party exists to get Republicans elected. I'm sure we all heard that, and we believe in that. But the real deep question is, what does that mean? Does that mean we just replicate what PACs and candidate campaigns do right now, which is spend money on mail and spend money on consultants? Or does it mean that we need to be re-envisioning the party for the future? Right now, funds go to outside groups because of that. So what we need to be doing with the state party is focusing on establishing an infrastructure so that when a citizen walks in and wants to be plugged into politics, that we do it effectively and efficiently. That means volunteering on a campaign. That means running for office. That means being in touch with politicians. We need to provide a way to get them all plugged into the party immediately. And that's the role of parties, to build a grassroots infrastructure and army.
All right, so thank you. So what is the Georgia Republican Party supposed to be doing? The Georgia Republican Party is supposed to lead the way amongst conservatives across our state. And in doing so, we have to obviously raise money to help our candidates get elected. We have to be the chief messenger for the conservative principles, if you believe. When you look at the party rules, you see that the chairman is basically the CEO of the Georgia Republican Party, but also the chief spokesman. So when people hear from the party, when they see the things that we're doing, what impression are they getting? So the person that set the leadership at the helm needs to be well-balanced in every area. So we say fundraising. We talk about messaging, communicate our vision. We have to engage our communities, because if we want to remain relevant in the state and our country, we cannot continue to think that we can win with the same group of people that have voted for us in the past. We have to engage all communities, young people. And I did that as a political director of the Georgia Young Republicans, as the Black Republican Council Chair, working with not just the Black community, but all communities, to bring them to our party, not wait for them to come to our meetings, but go to them. And you do that by making sure that people know you, and you know them, and you have to spend time to do that. And we have to work with all our counties, all 159, to train them and prepare them to work with state party to do all these things and more. Thank you.
We're all going to get our workout today. Standing up and going down. The role of the Georgia Republican Party in state and local elections is to first and foremost make certain that we have a clear, fair playing field for candidates, men and women, that are prepared to hold themselves up for office. The Georgia Republican Party need have a process whereby we allow and embrace all participants in the primary process, again, in a fair, equitable fashion, because we need to embrace the fact that these men and women are holding themselves up for elective office, of which is a huge job. Secondly, the Georgia Republican Party has to have the resources available once the nominee and nominees are selected. The critical part of a primary process is after the primary, most candidates will come out broke. The reality is the Georgia Republican Party must be then in a position to fill the void, be able to be on television, provide the mailers while they are retooling and doing what's necessary to take on the Democrats in the fall. As importantly, the Georgia Republican Party must embrace the grassroots conservatives. I'll be quiet. Thank you.
There's red and yellow up here, folks.
So what's the role of the party? The role of the party is whatever we want it to be, because we are the party. So it can be what it's always been. It can be something different. If we keep doing what we're doing, it will cease to exist. So you want to know what the role of the party is? You tell me. I know what I think I want it to be. But what do you want it to be when you in tomorrow and the future? So we're going to make a decision on what we want the party to be. And I hope we make it right.
Given what you've each described as what you think the role of the party is, tell us about what you see as the staffing priorities and the spending priorities. I'm not asking for names or anything like that, but give us an idea of what the staffing levels look like under your leadership, and how do we decide how we spend our money and prioritize the spending of that.
It's okay, I'm going to sit here. Can we agree to do that? So, you know, when we talk about certainly in a situation where we've got to do a better job with our finances and party, so we've got to make tough decisions. We've got to get down to the bare bones. What do we need to run the party? You know, as far as full-time staff, right now we have an executive director, a political director, we have minority engagement staff, and we have a finance person here in the party. So we've got to have somebody that obviously can help work with the funds that are coming in and out of the party, so that we make sure we're keeping in compliance with federal and state law. We need someone there day to day that can interact with the grassroots of our party and make sure that their questions are being answered, make sure that we're helping them to do the things that they need to do at the county level with elected officials at their level. We focus a lot on the president and even the governor, but we need to make sure Republicans are winning at all levels. And so we need those staff. We need to make sure that they're professional, that they're responsive, and that they understand the grassroots, because this is a grassroots organization. So we're going to have to make some tough decisions and look at exactly what we can do and what we can't do right now and deal with it.
Next is John.
An organization chart is a strategic document. It reflects your priorities. It's where you want to take an organization. It's what you find is important. Today, the organization chart of the Georgia Republican Party does not have a finance director, does not have a deputy finance director. Just as when Rusty Paul became chairman, the first hire, humbly that was me as the finance director. The first job that I would fill would be the finance director, deputy finance director. Again, 1995, folks, we had two in-house employees in the Georgia Republican Party who were focused solely and singularly on raising money. If we don't have that type of perspective and priority, we will not accomplish our goals. Certainly we need an executive director. In the current state of the environment, I would envision a political director and executive director who are one and the same until we got our house in order, until we defined what our priorities were, understood what our budget was, and we moved from there. That's what I would do.
Well, the first thing you have to do is understand what your as-is state is. Where are we today and what do we have? Then we have to define the to-be state, and that's where we want to be. And then you start looking at the gaps and then do an analysis between the two. Once you've got that gap analysis, then you can start preparing a roadmap on the way that you get from where you are to where you want to be. And then you start looking for funding mechanisms to make those things happen. And once the funding mechanisms begin begin to flow, and then you can execute the plan that you started out. And at the end of the day, you end up with a very good plan, a very executable plan, and a very financially secure plan.
The number one staffing priority for the state Republican Party is to focus on the grassroots. We need staff that are focusing on serving the people of this state. That means serving the county party chairman, serving the district party chairman, and answering every question and request with how, what can I do? What can I do to help with that problem? Instead of, that's not our problem. If you look at the fundraising letters coming from the state GOP right now, and to some extent national GOP, you'll see that the main thing that's in there is just, give us money, we get Republicans elected. But what help is that going to the county parties themselves? And that's what we need to be focused on. Because at the beginning, the party's currently underwater. We're getting the second staffing priority is making sure that we have insurance to cover the current $300,000 of legal fees that's been brought up in the racial discrimination lawsuit that just a couple days ago is still going on. Part of the summary judgment motion was denied 3 days ago on Wednesday. So that case is going to be going, and we're going to need in the future to avoid lawsuits. Insurance helps that, and staff that are well trained and well prepared will do that.
For the next question, we're going to be starting with John Watson. It was brought to my attention that in this coming cycle, and the cycle in which y'all are all running for office, we're going to be seeing a significant shift in delegates out of Metro Atlanta due to losses in the major counties and towards specifically primarily North Georgia, excluding those major counties. How is this going to change the nature of our party, and what does this say about how we need to reconfigure either our message or our resources?
To continue winning statewide elections, we have to have a very simple strategy. We have to obviously continue to focus on the metro, but as we see the changing votes in the metropolitan Atlanta, many times that is going to become the battleground. We're going to have to fight it out, tooth and nail, organize, work with the grassroots, do what's necessary in metro. But again, that's the battleground, a place where we will run up our numbers, where we will continue to win elections. The model that we use successfully for Governor Perdue was in North Georgia and South Georgia. The party must understand and embrace the fact that the numbers and the votes that are available to us are indeed and increasingly becoming North and South Georgia. Our priorities in terms of our staffing, our allocation of resources, and the organization that we do must reflect that. That's how we'll continue to win elections statewide.
Well, all I've got to say is welcome to the rest of the state, y'all. We've been fighting this and working with it in the 12th district for a couple of years now, recognizing the strength of the outlying areas. And you can see that the Trump campaign used this very effectively. That's how they actually won Wisconsin and Michigan and Pennsylvania, is overwhelming the metropolitan area with running up vote totals in the outlying areas of the state. There are a lot of very loyal Republican voters that don't live in the metro area. And we need to focus on them and get them the resources they need. And then we need to turn the metro area into what it really is always wanted to be, is a battleground area for us to be incredibly successful and not a money source, but a very well-positioned place for the future.
The shift of votes to the rural parts of the state is due to Donald Trump's success in the presidential election. That is the major part of it. Donald Trump and all of his supporters in all the outlying counties in rural areas of the state were sick and tired of being treated like they didn't matter by a paid political industry and a paid political class and lobbyists who tend to think that they know better than the people in those parts of the state. And unless the Republican Party starts focusing on serving the people, then it's going to bode disaster for the Republican Party in Georgia. In DeKalb County, where I'm from, we lost 15,000 Republican votes in this last election. That's how much it dropped. I know Cobb dropped very significantly, Gwinnett dropped, Fulton dropped. All of these counties with huge populations are losing. And unless the Republican Party can teach people and show people how our principles help their lives and how we are not the racist bigots that the CNN puts out there, which we all know we are, then we're going to lose. We need to be educating on the grassroots level, or we're going to lose the state.
three things that I think are very key. One thing is that regarding Donald Trump and his presidency, when people around the state look at the leadership, they want to know that the chairman is going to support the nominee. And there's plenty of evidence out there that is, in my role as first vice chair, I got out front supporting Donald Trump. When Hillary Clinton was saying he was a part of the Klan, I worked with the state Trump campaign to put out a press release saying that was ridiculous and talking about how Hillary Clinton does not need to be our next president. And the grassroots and all the folks around our state need to see individuals leading and showing that we're supporting a nominee. A second thing is, and it was mentioned earlier, Henry County is certainly not Republican today. And I helped, and several of us helped, June Wood, black Republican female in Henry County. She won the chairmanship in the county commission, and she got bipartisan support because of the principles that we believe. So we can win Gwinnett County again. We can win Cobb again. We can win this whole state, this whole country, to work together. And finally, we've got to respect all the people from all 159 counties. We've got to go to them and work with them so we win at all levels and not just focus on Metro.
During this last election, you can really look at the map of Georgia, and it was the rural counties that delivered for Donald Trump, picking up a lot of the slack that would previously have been taken up by the suburban counties in Atlanta. At the same time, we're hearing about some issues in rural areas. The ones I can think of specifically relate to rural broadband in areas outside of Metro Atlanta, and rural hospitals staying open. And then we also have in South Georgia, we've got a major agriculture industry that has a different relationship to the federal government than most industries do, a greater level of reliance on the federal government. How do we reconcile the demands and the requirements of rural Georgia with the Republican principles that tend to be more towards limited government and staying out of business, staying out of decisions like those? To recognize the fact that we are 159 counties. We will be starting with Mike Welsh this time.
Well, agriculture is very important in the 12th district. And when you talk to farmers down there, one of the most important things they ask for is just pick a set of rules and leave us alone. And really, the hospital situation in rural Georgia, if you're not familiar, it is desperate, folks. It is desperate. And the Obamacare law really set us up for failure in that arena. And what we need to do is continue to work with our strongest advocate now, Tom Price, in the HHS to get that taken care of. Because servicing rural folks with decent health care and with broadband isn't really as hard as it seems using conservative Republican principles. It's called private-public partnerships. They've been working all over the globe, but especially in areas such as this. So what's the incentive? Well, we have to find it and make it real for them so that they can have those incentives to be positive impacts for those areas that are lightly served under today's environment.
Thanks, Todd. As I've said for years, we need politicians to be accountable to the people that elected them. That's the most important thing in government, is that the politicians are accountable to us. Not just the people in this room, but the people that voted them into office. And the way to make that happen should be through the Republican Party, through the idea that people who want to talk to their elected representatives and officials can come to the Republican Party and learn where they're speaking, the contact information for the politicians, and be able to have a voice. Because in the end, elected officials want to do what's right. They want to serve the people. And the reason why a lot of times they don't is a breakdown of communication. The party can help provide that resource to the public so that the people can easily communicate with the politicians. Because right now, people don't know a lot of county parties exist and definitely don't know the state party exists. And the state party can help support that so that the people can talk and be organized with their elected officials. And if they don't like it, they can end up learning how to primary them and run against them if we help provide the resources.
Well, yes, one of the things we used to have in the state party is a newsletter. And I think we need to return to that. When the legislative session is starting up, we need to talk about the issues that are before our Republican elected officials under the Golden Dome and what's important to the grassroots. What are those issues? But there's any number of them. Right now, you know, we're still talking about transportation in the state. We're talking about casinos in the state. We're talking about health care and what we do about Obamacare and how that affects Georgia. So we ought to be talking principally about where we stand as Republicans and make sure those principles line up with the legislation and put that information out to the grassroots and say, hey, if you want to be a part of what's going forward, here's some information for you. Bring in organizations like Faith and Freedom and others to talk about these issues. And then say, hey, if you want to come to the Gold Dome, these bills are assigned to these committees, and here's some dates coming up. And really make sure that we do our part as a state party to inform people so that we can all make informed decisions, because this is our party, this is our state, and we need to be in control of that.
In Georgia, agriculture is the largest single economy, mover of the economy in our state. God bless President Trump for appointing Sonny Perdue Secretary of Agriculture. We can all be grateful for that, and I'm personally so. Georgia prospers under conservative governance. Georgia prospers, all of Georgia prospers, when taxes are low, when we prioritize economic development, when we prioritize education and workforce development. Georgia, in the past 15 years, has seen dramatic job growth under two governors, two Republican governors that have led by example, again, and with the men and women of the General Assembly, with conservative principles that are good for business, that are good for free enterprise, that incentivize investment, of which for all of Georgia will be a job creator for the future. That's something we've got to stick with, and why 2018 and the next governor's race is so critical for our future.
We'll start with Alex Johnson with this next question. What happened in Todd and Gwinnett counties, and how do we fix it?
And we have 1 minute, so.
I'm inclined to be a little bit loose with time on this if you come up with the right answer.
Todd and Gwinnett County, I believe that a significant part of the problem is the fact that we haven't been doing what was suggested earlier. We haven't been, as a state party, advertising what it is we stand for. We raise money throughout the years and we spend it on the general. It's not a, right now we are not spending it on education and grassroots infrastructure all year so that people are in communities that may not traditionally be Republican and explaining why our principles help their lives. When I ran for state senate in 2010, I was advised by political consultants and the party to not target black voters, to not target people who don't traditionally vote Republican. If the party's not doing it, the consultants aren't doing it, then who's going to be doing it? And that's the ultimate problem, is we need to be talking to people and explaining how our principles help their lives all year to combat the negative impression the media gives us all the time about Republicans. And that's what the party needs to be doing. And that's why we lost Bobby Gwinnett, is because we weren't doing that, and we won't be in the future without a new culture at the party.
And I'll talk about this again. Again, we cannot win in the future with the same model. We've got to grow our party. This nation is a center-right nation. But we have to be able to articulate the principles. During the election, we know that the liberal media is going to be against us. They're going to talk about us, lie about us, put up a lot of false information about our candidates, regardless of who they are. But we as a party have to combat that. What do we believe? What do we stand for? And how are we engaging all communities to ensure that that message gets out? And not give it lip service, but really talk to people and make sure that they hear beyond that noise. And you do that every day of the year. You do it with Gwinnett and Cobb and everywhere else. You stand up for your candidate. Now, we had 17 candidates, and everybody was all over the place about who they supported. But when Donald Trump was the nominee, it was time to stop talking about the other folks and get on board and do it in a public way. Support your candidate, engage all communities, and we will see Gwinnett and Cobb come back in our Republican side of the fence, so to speak, going forward, and we'll win the governor's race in 2018 and beyond.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, we lost Cobb, Gwinnett, and Henry because the Georgia Republican Party didn't have adequate resources. The reality is that the grassroots activism, the things that you all do, of which we should be all in all of, still require resources. If you don't have the phones, if you don't have the coordinators, if you don't have the yard signs, if you you don't have the paid messaging, then the reality is you cannot promote an effective message, in particular in communities that are indeed changing. We must recognize that nothing stays the same, nor has Cobb and Gwinnett, but the reality is that the votes are there. We have to pursue them vigorously, but we have to be adequately sourced and resourced. The grassroots need to have the ability and knowledge that the support from the party will be there to back them up in the battleground communities that those areas have become.
Well, the first thing to understanding why you lose is to really dig deep and figure out what happened. First of all, Cobb, Gwinnett, and Henry are not the same counties they were 10 or 15 years ago. The state's not the same as it was 10 or 15 years ago. But that doesn't mean it's an automatic disaster for us. The Republicans, our Democrats, were buying into this thing called the emerging dominance because of the changing demographics. Well, look what that got them. They lost everything in this cycle nationally. So we're not faced with certainty, but we are faced with the need to get our act together. And we need to start adopting predictive modeling, and so we know who the voters are, and we know why they're voting the way they're voting, and then we can reach the ones that are about to vote the way we want them to before they pull that lever.
One thing that a number of folks have pointed to as an issue for the Republican Party is the lack of female candidates, the lack of female elected officials. At the same time, we have always, as a party, been neutral in primaries between Republican candidates. Is there a need for the party to do something to foster female candidates? And if so, what do we do? And we are starting this round with Michael McNeely.
Yeah, you know, one important thing we need to do is have training. You know, we need training for new members of our party, we need training for volunteers, we need training for candidates, so that we're empowering them to get involved if they want to become Republican elected officials. When you talk about women specifically, as I mentioned earlier, I helped June Wood, a woman, a Republican in Henry County, and she won. I also helped in giving time and money and resources to Megan Hanson, House District 8, young professional female. She won her seat in House District 8. So I'm already part of helping women win Republican elections. And so if I'm the chair of the party, I'm going to continue to do that, but on a much larger scale, because there are some quality conservative women all across the state that need an opportunity to serve at whatever level they choose.
In terms of Republican women, first and foremost, that begins in my own house. My wife and I met while working at the Georgia Republican Party. It's indeed a family affair. We have two daughters, age 16 and 14, and we have a female dog, so I can assure you I am all good with female Republicans. Look, I don't see, when I'm looking at a female or a male candidate, and I previously have been a consultant in the process, the reality is I see someone without gender, without race, but one that is able to articulate the core message that is Republicanism. I think that we should embrace any and all members that have a common shared goal. The reality is we need the women's vote, very clearly, but nonetheless, Todd's a really interesting question. I'm good with women, that's all, we're good.
Talent identification is really the most important thing that any organization does. And we fall flat on our face in a lot of cases. In other cases, we do an exceptionally good job. But what we need to do is do a good job all the time. So we need to develop talent. We need to identify it, and we need to encourage it at all levels. And it doesn't have to just be women. I mean, there are lots of minorities that should be stepping up to the plate. Why? Because they can. All we need to do is encourage them to do the right thing. And let them know that we'll be behind them, not 100%, but 110%.
Now, obviously, I don't think we should start copying the identity politics of the Democrats or taking sides in primaries, but I think it is important that we need more women candidates, and actually all candidates. One experience I had this last cycle as president of the Republican Assembly is I was helping train people in Cobb County about how to get involved in the Republican Party. Through that, I met a lady who seemed to be very, very committed to politics. She's been in business for years, a very important professional networker, so to speak. And someone said, well, you should run for office. And she's like, she immediately got scared. And she was like, well, how would I do that? What would I do? And that's the thing that I think we miss. Those of us involved in the party, we might know how to go to trainings, we may know how to run for office, we may know how to qualify, find consultants, people in the industry, campaign managers, but what we need to be doing is growing that base, growing the pool of people that know how to be involved and know how to be good Republicans. And by that, we will get more female candidates. But first, we need more people involved in the Republican Party. So when you mention you're involved, people don't look at you and ask, where's they meet? Where do they meet? What's that? So that's where I think we need to go.
This is a little bit confusing for me. One of the things that I often hear from party activists is that we go out and we elect these great candidates who say all the right things, and then they go to Atlanta and they start voting against the principles that we elected them to uphold. Is there a role for the state party in maintaining some form of Republican ideology or Republican discipline once somebody gets elected? Or is that something that's out of the party's hands? This goes to John Munson first.
The ultimate accountability for the behavior of an elected official is at the ballot box. And the reality is that every 2 years for members of the General Assembly, of course, every 4 years for governor and statewide office. The accountability that comes in the ballot box is fundamental to our democracy, fundamental to our republic, fundamental to an elected body. And that's where they need, and we need, to put our feet and our voice when we believe folks are doing wrong. In terms of the party, a platform, I believe in the platform of the Republican National Committee. It's reviewed every 4 years. It's voted on by the members of the National Committee every 4 years. I have every desire to embrace that in the process. In terms of other principles, we do need to address and talk about the fact that there are a basket of things, not deplorables, but adorables. limited government, adherence to the Constitution, free enterprise, the things that bind us that don't divide us, that's what we need to focus on.
It's very important for the party to speak as a voice and to help those that are in elected office to recognize that we have that voice and we can encourage them through that voice to understand and adhere to those principles throughout the legislative process, because they're hearing lots of voices as that process is occurring. And some of their constituents, and some of them are some lobbyists, and some of them are some just friends. So do we talk to them? Do we whisper in their ear as a party? Well, we should be.
As president of the Georgia Republican Assembly, which is the state chapter of a national organization, we endorse candidates in contested primaries. The reason why we do that is because the party doesn't, and because we have a one-page statement of principles that are all Republican. You can look it up on georgiara.com, that are basic Republican principles. And the point being that people in the public deserve to know who's standing by the principles. Now, the party has to be a neutral arbiter as being an organization that lets everyone on the ballot. But we need to have a grassroots army involved in the party so that they know what the elected officials are doing. It's not enough to say, well, whoever wins at the ballot box is good. Because look at Donald Trump. He had to beat the political industry from the Democrats and the Republicans to get elected, the people who are fine with non-accountability. What we need for accountability is informed people. And the way to make that happen is by getting more people tied in to rooms like this, because everybody in here knows what's going on. And that's what we need to have expanded throughout the public.
I mentioned earlier we need to go back to having a newsletter to educate grassroots around the state about the issues. We should play a role in that. Yes, people can go out and get information on their own as well. I think the Georgia Republican Party ought to also be putting out the information to to the voters around the state, specifically the grassroots. You know, also, listen, we as people, you know, we complain when things aren't right, but we need to equally celebrate when things aren't. And our Georgia Republican elected officials are doing a lot of great things, and we need to celebrate that. But when they're doing things that we don't agree with, we can respectfully speak against that. And I know with the religious liberty legislation, I personally wrote a letter of support, put it out on social media, where I supported the legislation. Now, that was in conflict with some of our Republican elected officials. But I took a stand because I believe in the principles of our party, and I did respect it. So I think there's a role for our party to do that and be respectful and still work with our elected officials at all levels and be balanced.
Thank you. I got a number of questions before we started, and I've tried to roll some of those into the questions I've asked, and I've got one of those in the lightning round. I didn't tell you all before, but we're going to have a lightning round. But this is a question from an audience member. What have each of you done to support your local or district county party and to support candidates in your local elections?
Well, as the chairman of the 12th district, we've been a very vibrant. We hosted the only non-metro call center for the Trump campaign that was in the state of Georgia. So we found a building, we funded it, we put the staff in, we got the infrastructure in place, and we raised the money for that. Not only raised enough money for that office, but we also raised money to send down to local sheriff's race down in Coffee County, a little county at the end of 3.5 hours away from us at the other end of the district. And that's exactly the kind of work that I'll do when I'm chairman.
Well, in DeKalb County, I've specifically served as legal counsel of the county party. When it comes down to actually growing and supporting the party, most of my time recently has been devoted to growing the statewide Republican Assembly. And by doing that, we actually had a chapter start in DeKalb County. That chapter then turned around and hosted a debate among some of the candidates running in a runoff. They're Democratic candidates, sadly, but that was a good thing, because what we ended up doing is getting our principles, that one state page statement of beliefs I told all of you about, to a new group of people who may not normally be voting our way, and our principles out to that part of the county. So what I've been doing is helping try to get more people tied into politics, tied in and involved in the politics. And most of the credit for that event goes to the great guy in DeKalb County. He's the chairman of the DeKalb chapter of the assembly, who recruited Doug Hartman. And I want to make sure to spread that around. But if you look statewide, that's what I've been working on, is getting people involved and tied in, because to a large extent, the state GOP hasn't been successful.
I mentioned some candidates earlier that I worked with during the cycle, June Wood, Megan Hansen. I also supported Chuck Payne in the special election state Senate seat. So getting out there, going door to door, phone banking, writing checks to support the candidates, that's what I've been doing. And then, you know, previously when Governor Deal was running for re-election, you know, one of the issues that he focused on was juvenile and adult criminal justice reform. And I brought him to my church with over 20,000 members, with 4,000 seat sanctuary, predominantly black men and women in that church. And we don't normally allow candidates to speak about their campaigns, but I convinced my pastor to allow Governor Deal to talk about the reform and how it helps so many people, whether it was people that are directly tied to the individuals from that legislation or people outside of the communities. But they heard from him and they gave him a standing ovation. And that's what we need to be working on, the principles and how they apply to policy and how we help our elected officials get elected. David Perdue, running for Senate, would work with the Morehouse to help induce the phone banking. I mean, so I could go on and on. I've been involved at the grassroots level with campaigns for years, and we have to keep doing that. We have to ensure that people see the example from us that we're doing that. We're willing to roll up our sleeves and help people of all levels to win it, because we're Republicans, and we've made this state great because of our principles, and we continue for years to come.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've been working for 25 years to kick down the door such that conservatives and Republicans were in the majority. That time has been spent at the statewide level, working at the Georgia Republican Party, working with statewide candidates, and thereby working with local communities, local parties. Every statewide race I've been involved in, we've had a communal bond with 159 counties to make certain that our grassroots strategy was viable and could win. That's where my focus has been. I live in Cobb County, went to Cobb County today, my wife and I will be delegates. But the truth is, and you all must know, among each and all of us, we have skill sets and we have experiences. I take no back seat to the fact that I have been involved at the statewide level, again, kicking down the door and doing what's necessary for the majority that we have today and where we'll be in the future.
This is the confuse the moderator. Okay, so we're starting with Alex next. Okay, so I've got individual questions for each of the four folks. Alex, you have been involved in our party for a number of years, but you've never run one of the major organizations, one of the major official organizations. You're not one of the state executive committee members, are you?
No.
And you probably have less experience than the rest of your the rest of the candidates. How is your youth and the differences in your experience, how is that an asset for you and how is that an asset for the party? Go ahead and address that in any way you want.
Appreciate that. I'm very good friends with a number of people who've been on the executive committee and the state committee for the state party. And for all of you who don't know, the executive committee runs the party between state committee meetings. The state committee runs the party between conventions. Notice that those committees are run the party, but not just the chairman. That's a problem right now, because what's been going on is that the chairman just runs the party, and to a large extent, the other people don't have much of a say-so, much of a stake in it. So when it comes down to the question of why I've been running for any of those positions, it's because I don't just want to title. I want to cause change. And that's what I've been doing for the Georgia Republican Assembly, which is a statewide organization that went from five people or six people when I took over about a year ago to over 150 with four local chapters now that have done events around the state. And we have members from around the state, dues-paying members, not just some list. So in the end, I've been working to make this happen. I've been working to grow the party while the state party and that executive committee has been failing. So I haven't been on it because it hasn't been working, and the cultural change will start at the top with the chairman. So that's what I bring to the table, and my age is an advantage.
I started out calling all these gentlemen friends beforehand, and I hope I can do so afterwards. But I do think these are fair questions. Michael, you've addressed this a little bit in the press, but some of us will have additional questions. You said you worked at one of the major state agencies. How will that inhibit your ability to call for change in what state government is doing in the role as chairman? Is there a conflict of interest there? How is that going to work out for you and for the party?
Well, when you think about what the chairman needs to do, they need to make fundraising calls, do the rolling up the sleeves, canvas, get elected, doing media requests, going to county meetings, traveling all around the state. I'm doing that now, and I've been doing that very well. And I've been doing that for years, even before I was first vice chair. So there's no conflict there. In fact, one of the things that's required through the agency is a political activity form that you fill out and get approval from the agency. So I did that when I ran for first vice chair. I did that when I ran for chair. So there's no conflict. Everybody has the ability to have free speech. And I certainly wouldn't be out talking bad about my agency, but I can talk about principles in which legislation is being pushed forward and the ideas that I have based on those principles, just as I did with the religious freedom legislation. There were no issues there, and there won't be any for my chairman.
Thank you. Do I have any idea what the question is?
None.
Has been as a paid lobbyist.
That's right.
How is that going to affect, are there going to be conflicts of interest for you there, and how is that going to affect your ability to chair the party?
Would have never guessed that. Here's the real deal, folks. I think it's high time the Georgia Republican Party and the grassroots activists that make up this party had a lobbyist advocating for them at the Georgia General Assembly and with elected officials. I know how to do that. I will do that. It is a role the state chairman need play. Yes. Beyond that, I live in a regulated environment. Each and every member of this room can go on the state ethics website and review exactly who it is that I work for. No one else on this stage can say where their money comes from, and God bless them, they don't have to. I do. Each and every one can and should do that. I'll give you my cell phone. I'll tell you exactly who it is that I work for and what they're asking me to do. Third, beyond that, everyone knows and talks about and believes what happens at the Gold Dome, and some of it is true. The reality is that in you go dinners, this, that, or the other, again, go on the state ethics website. I don't do dinners. I'll challenge you to find a member of the General Assembly that can remember the last time I went to dinner with them, because I do my job. I do so proudly. I advocate on behalf of my clients, and I go home to my family.
Mike, one of the things that sets you apart is you're not from the metro Atlanta area. You're, about 2 hours from metro Atlanta? How is that going to be? Is that going to be a challenge for you to maintain leadership of an organization that's headquartered 2 hours away and where the vast majority of the voting public and the vast majority of Republican votes are outside of a one-hour drive from you?
Well, first of all, it's not the Atlanta Republican Party. It's the Georgia Republican Party. And not too many years ago, they came up with this neat little device called a cell phone, a smartphone. And I don't mean to make flippant of that, but it's amazing what you can do. And before I took the job that I have now, I ran an independent consulting business for 17 years. And one of the big projects that I ran was a redesign of a brand new vehicle from the ground up. And we actually contracted with engineers in Mumbai, India, and designers in Detroit and testing facilities in Detroit. And we literally ran that design operation 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So it's amazing what you can do when you have a good plan and good leadership and the right people in the right spots. So I would say it's actually an advantage to me, because I know how to achieve things that are done through people, not by me, by myself. So I can leverage other folks to help us do the things we need to do. And I have no doubt that I can bring the leadership that's needed, even though I'm not actually physically sitting in Atlanta.
Thank you all for your answers. We're now going to do a lightning round. Is it going to be okay if we don't pass the microphone for this? If it gets to where you're having trouble hearing, just let me know somehow visually or yell at me. But we're going to start with Alex, and we're going to go down the line each time. Casino gambling, yes or no?
No. No. I advocate for casino gambling. Here's why. I believe the people of Georgia deserve the opportunity to take elected officials and politicians out of the decision-making process and make the direct decision and put this to bed once and for all. It's up to the people.
Mike?
No.
Who did you vote for president in 2008, starting with Alex?
McCain.
2012?
Romney.
2016?
Trump and wrote a check to Trump.
Trump.
The way I'm scoring is I'm giving Alex an extra point for remembering who was on the ballot. I'd be glad I didn't ask who you supported in the primary. Pro-life, yes or no?
Yes.
Definitely pro-life is being adopted.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Did you support or oppose the Opportunity School District amendment on the ballot last year?
I supported.
What is the number one issue that the Georgia Republican Party has neglected to address?
Cultural issues of the entire leadership of the party.
Financial stewardship.
The Georgia Republican Party has forgotten that it works for you.
Technological embrace.
Embracing technology. I don't need the mic, but if you can just raise your voice at all.
Do we need to go and redo that?
No, that's okay.
I said the culture of the state party.
Yeah, I heard that.
And I said financial stewardship.
I didn't hear Mr. Welsh. Welsh, sorry.
Embracing technology.
Okay, thank you.
Give the Georgia Republican Party a letter grade for 2014.
D.
C.
D.
C minus. Letter grade for 2016.
D minus.
D minus. It's called failing and going back a grade.
D.
Would you support or oppose religious liberty legislation in the General Assembly? I'm speaking specifically of Josh McCoon's bill, just because there were so many.
Amendments, let's you refresh on which version you're referring to.
Okay, that's a tough one. His would have prevented, let's see. I can't do it, and I can't have Josh McCoon calling me to tell him. Campus carry legislation.
Completely supported.
Support.
Yes.
Strong support.
What do you order at Waffle House as your default order?
Two quarters, hash browns, and grits.
Egg and cheese sandwich, scattered, smothered, and covered.
I like it all. So I'm eggs, I want the grits, and I want the waffle itself.
I'm sorry. It's salt, not sugar.
I'm sorry, the All-Star Special is the right answer.
We need a support.
We're now going to have a 3-minute close from everyone, and we're going to do it in reverse order. So we'll start with Mike Welsh for a 3-minute close.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, tonight we've heard a lot of great questions, and we've heard a lot of great answers. But the bottom line is all just talk. So what really matters is trust. And who are you going to trust with this precious organization we call the Georgia Republican Party for the next couple of years? Who's going to care for it? It reminds me of the story of the guy walking down the beach. He comes across this gentleman, and he's standing there in front of all these starfish that have been washed up. And he's reaching down and taking those starfish and chunking them out in the ocean one at a time. And the guy looks at him and says, "Are you crazy? What's the matter?" And he picks one out, and he reaches down and grabs it, throws it, says, "Matter to that one." Picks another one up, throws it in, says, "Matter to that one." Well, the bottom line is, you matter to me. And I hope to earn your trust as the next chairman of the Republican Party. Thank you very much.
Folks, thank you for being here. Thank you for the opportunity to address you. The Georgia Republican Party that we love, adore, and appreciate is not prepared to take on the responsibilities of 2018. We do not have adequate resources. We do not have the proper engagement of grassroots. We have lost our way. The reality is, I am the only former professional fundraiser on this stage. I am the only former field general that has run a campaign statewide and won. And we must admit, we must go on a wartime footing against our opponents as we prepare for 2018. As you discern, of which are all wonderful characteristics of the gentleman on this stage, you must discern the leader for the time that we find ourselves in. And I would ask for your support and humbly say that I fit the times the best. Thank you, and I hope everyone on this stage drives safely as we drove home to our families tonight. Sir.
The Georgia Republican Party is a
We need to work with our elected Republican officials. We need to work with people that can write the checks, but we should not be beholden to any of them. When we talk about what we need to do in our party, engaging minority communities, engaging millennials, listen, we can talk about it, but I've done that over the years. As political director of the Georgia Republicans, Black Republican Council Chair, and helping candidates get elected just recently in this election cycle. When you talk about messaging and making sure that we get beyond the noise of the liberal media and articulating our message, I've done that. When you talk about supporting our candidates, Donald J. Trump, I dare you to find anything out there that does not support Donald J. Trump as first vice chair of this party when I did that. And I challenge you to look and see what all of us on this stage has done to support our now president of the United States. We've got to move forward. Our problems are surmountable, insurmountable, in a lot of regards to a lot of people. But I'm telling you today that we can overcome each and every one of them. When we talk about the fundraising and finances, listen, you got to stop bleeding. You got to have a budget. You got to not spend more than you bring in. That's fundamental to being a conservative. This isn't financial Armageddon. We can fix this. We're in a red state. We've got all elected officials at all levels that are Republicans. Now it's time to show leadership, being good fiscal stewards, and being able to command a room of grassroots warriors to continue to win for years to come. You've got a choice amongst us. Make the decision, but make it with all the facts, with everything on the table, understanding there are multiple issues that we need to face, and we've got individuals on the stage that can or cannot address those. You have to make that choice. And at any time for me, I can answer any of your questions anytime via cell phone, email, whatever you need. We can talk after because I'm here for you. And whatever happens at the end of the day, I'm a fiscal and social conservative, I'm a Georgia Republican, and we're gonna continue to win for years to come. Thank you.
Thank you all for having me here today. Thank you to my fellow candidates for other candidates for coming and having a good debate. What I'm here today to tell you is that, again, we need to be focused on our brand and party credibility. Those are the that's the most important thing, followed by growing county parties, focusing on the resources and training necessary to make it so we can grow a grassroots army, so that those 2 million Republican voters in this state, that not less than 1% knows about and is involved with the party. Then we have at least 1% and hopefully 5 or 10% that know about us. Because right now, 2 million Republican voters, and we probably have less than 10,000 that are involved with us regularly. That needs to change. And that's what I will change as chairman. I am the only candidate that's been leading a statewide grassroots organization and growing it over the past year with 4 local chapters. I mean, it's grown from about 5 or 6 to over 150 people. That's what we've been doing around the state. That's what I've been doing to help out. I've been going to the Cobb County when the campaign was doing the primary, bringing people in, letting them know how to be involved in the party process, and being delegates to conventions. During the primary last year, there were between 75 and 150 Trump voters up in Cobb County coming a week to these meetings, not involved in the party. And no one from the party was there to bring them in. No one. I was bringing them. I was teaching them how to be involved. When Claire Harrison from Cobb County was running that group, she's the one who invited me to help do that. She did a great job coordinating Cobb County for Trump. And in the end, that's what we need. We need to be working with people and growing the party, working with the president, the volunteers of the presidential campaigns, not just the insiders, the political insiders, and the lobbyists, and the consultants, but actually working with the grassroots, focused on the grassroots, because that's the only way the party will survive and thrive in the future, is by focusing on the people. I'm the only candidate that's been doing that. I'm the only candidate that's been sending out a newsletter for the past 4 years. You go to advancethegop.com, it will show you everything that I've thought, been talking about, and trying to bring people into the party for 4 years. Advancethegop.com, 4 years of history. You need someone credible, because every year people make the same promises in party leadership, but in the end, things don't seem to change. They've only gotten worse, as the questions earlier talked about. And the only way we're going to change things is by being a credible leader of the party who can walk into rooms and be credible with donors and let them know, hey, I'm the real deal. I'm not part of the old system, and I'm not beholden to anybody. We have a new vision. We're going to grow this army. We're going to grow the party. We're going to help county parties with everything they need in order to be successful, because we need to be serving you, not the other way around.
Amen.
Thank you all very much, and we're around for questions.
Thank you for making the journey. Dahlonega, Georgia. We want to thank our moderator, Todd Rehm, for doing such a phenomenal job. Who has live streamed this debate for us so that people who could not be here in person tonight could see it. I know that many of you will want to speak to our candidates. However, our candidates have agreed to a 5-minute interview with Mr. Pritchard immediately following this. So I am going to whisk them from this table back there to him so that he can do that. As they finish, you're welcome to mingle and you're also welcome to talk with them as well. Thank you to Bruce Acevedo, our district chairman here, for allowing me to help facilitate this event for the evening. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attendance, and this concludes our event.
You're welcome to do that.
Yeah, did you get my information?
I did.